Dr. Elisabeth Kübler-Ross has made a profound contribution to the world through her work with dying patients. Early in life, she learned the importance of listening, an art which she has refined and polished in her work as a psychiatrist. At Billings Memorial Hospital in Chicago, Elisabeth's dying patients gave her permission to invite both medical and theology students to join her at the bedside as she talked with them about their feelings and concerns at the end of life. In 1967, her book on death and dying opened the door to the death education movement. Each year, she now travels thousands of miles to give lectures and workshops. She has recently established the Elisabeth Kübler-Ross Center at Headwaters, Virginia, which she now calls home. At the University of Washington in Seattle, courses in death and dying have been offered to students in the health professions through the Department of Biomedical History at the School of Medicine. I am Dr. Thomas McCormick, a lecturer in bioethics in the Department of Biomedical History. Since joining the faculty in 1974, the enrollment of students from many disciplines in my courses in death and dying have steadily grown. In this videotape, Elisabeth discusses with me a variety of issues pertinent to caring for the dying patient. Topics include truth-telling and intuitive awareness, patient rights in choosing and refusing medical treatment, and the importance for health professionals of attending to our unfinished business. Repressed feelings may interfere with our capacity to truly listen and faithfully respond to the deepest concerns of dying patients and their families. Elisabeth, in over 10 years of teaching courses in death and dying at the School of Medicine, we have drawn on your books and films and videotapes as resources for the medical students and others in the health professions. It's a real pleasure to be able to talk with you in person today about a concern we have in common. To begin
nice
with,
to be back.
Thank you. To begin, it appears to me that over the last decade or so, physicians and other health professionals have become more candid and more straightforward in talking to patients about the nature of their diagnosis and appropriately their prognosis. As I've reflected on this, it seems due in part to the fact that some of our modern treatment of cancer in particular requires the patient's cooperation, and the application of technology must have the informed consent of the patient. It seems also that there is a growing sensitivity to patient rights. As I understand your own experience, there's also the conviction on your part that patients seem to learn intuitively about the truth of their situation, whether they're told explicitly or not.
They know on many, many levels, in a way more than we know. We as healthcare givers or professionals, but they don't know it from the intellectual quadrant. They know a lot from the cues of the changed behavior of the family, of the nurses, the doctors, the hospital chaplain. But the other part, which we really need to teach more in medical school, is that people know from their intuitive quadrant, inner knowledge, and the more sick they are and the longer they suffer, or the longer they have been in a hospital and kind of isolated and no longer involved in the outside world. It's like your world begins to shrink. Your activities, your involvement begin to shrink. And in a way, the smaller your world becomes, your world meaning the patient's world, the more he becomes introspective and hears his own inner wisdom, and that's what we call the spiritual intuitive quadrant. And if we would teach hospital personnel to know the symbolic language better and to pick up the cues of what people know from here, not from here, working with terminally ill and critically ill people would be an incredible gift, because it teaches you a totally different level of communication. And a lot of people just omit that or say, oh, that's nothing, we know best. And they stick to their intellectual quadrant and they don't know how much they miss.
It's like becoming too literal.
Yes.
Believing that only that which is said explicitly and literally is the truth, when in fact the nonverbal communication and then the inner dialogue is so much a part of that truth.
And not only do the patients evolve and get more tuned into themselves, but if you really get involved as a patient, not over-identify with, but really get involved, and you can sit and hear and listen and not be distracted or look at the watch, just tune in. They can teach you so much. And if I can share my intellectual knowledge and the statistics and the probability which treatment is the best and all the alternatives, and I share that with my patients, then the other half, and that's the neglected part in medical schools and nursing schools, then the patient shares with me what they know internally. And if we put those two things together, our chances of really helping each other and of both being a student and a teacher is enormous.
It really becomes a dialogue then.
Yes, mm-hmm. and a real, literal sharing and growing together.
Mm-hmm.
And people who say, well, you know, I'm the doctor and you're the patient, I'm the giver and you're the receiver, they miss a big part of what it's like, a doctor-patient relationship. And university hospitals, where kids come to the emergency room or to get, just come in for a treatment and then leave again, and you have different doctors mm-hmm. all the time, or different nurses, we lose a lot of that because you cannot really tune in to every patient when you have a very limited time and you have 50 people waiting in a waiting room.
Mm-hmm.
That's something we have to review, our whole healthcare system, how much we lose in the process of being more efficient.
Mm-hmm.
It may be efficient time-wise and energy-wise, but in the process of it, we lose an enormous deal that would benefit not only the patient, but also the caregiver.
We lose touch with that human side of the treatment.
Yeah, and it's not only the human side. It's like you could grow enormously on an intuitive, spiritual level. And if your intellectual quadrant is, I call it hypertrophic,
mm-hmm.
and you only believe in that, you don't know what you miss.
Mm-hmm.
But you also help many less patients.
Mm-hmm.
You help them to a degree, and then when it becomes controversial, or a patient tells you no thank you, no more chemotherapy, and you don't hear it, then you deprive them of their free choice.
Mm-hmm.
Then you make the family guilty for, quote, giving up hope, mm-hmm. or all sorts of guilt trips we put on them.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I know best, you don't know, you can't know, I've had so many years of experience. And then they feel guilty not listening to you. And the end result is miserable, because then those kids die in the midst of a treatment, or they're rolled, you know, on a stretcher to an X-ray and they die in a hallway instead of hearing when they say, this is it,
mm-hmm.
and then you accept that they know,
mm-hmm.
and you take them home and they can die in mom's arms or with dad around or the brothers and sisters.
Mm-hmm.
So you really don't enhance the quality of their life. You also don't enhance the quality of your life, because once you have experience, by God, it really works, and you become more humble. And as you get more humble, you will hear more. It's like a vicious cycle.
Mm-hmm.
And that aspect we have to teach more.
Mm-hmm.
The only way you can teach it is by experience.
Mm-hmm.
You can lecture, you know, 1,000 times. If they're not open, they say, well, that's a nice daydream, or romanticizing, or all sorts of labels. But once you've had a patient who tells you, today's my last treatment, and you hear them, the change that occurs in the family and in a patient and with your own humility is just beautiful.
Mm-hmm. Young physicians, residents, and particularly interns who are really beginning to intensify their clinical experience agonize with me at times over this kind of tension between wanting to do what's best for their patient and wanting to offer all the medical curative therapies that are available, and yet also wanting to respect the respect the autonomy of the patient in determining what level and intensity and duration of care they want.
If we would raise our kids before they go to medical school or in a seminary or nursing school, if we would raise them to be as much as possible in harmony between the physical, emotional, spiritual, and intellectual quadrant, it would be less of a conflict. Mm-hmm. But that starts really when you're 1 year old. If you can hear your patients and try to keep a balance and say, again with humility, statistically, this would really work, this is great. And you give them all the pro and contra of a treatment, including the negative and the nausea and the hair loss and whatever it entails, the costs and the time in the hospital. And then give them equal time to share their concerns, mm-hmm. and give them time to think about it, not kind of flood them and we can't lose time, we really have to start tonight or tomorrow. And if they have doubts, you wait. If you have doubts, a patient will not participate. He will not fight with you towards the same goal. Mm-hmm. My golden rule, and I guess everybody has their own little gimmicks, is never ever to ask a patient more than 3 times. I would tell a patient, chemotherapy is the best treatment of choice for your type of malignancy, for example. It entails this and that. And I can see in their face that they close off the more I talk. And they say, would you rather have a week to think about it? And they say, yes, my uncle had that kind of chemotherapy and he was miserable. I say, fine, why don't you talk to a few more people who've had that kind of treatment? And you don't pick only the good ones, you know, who are not nauseated and mm-hmm. all that, but you give them a random choice of 2-3 people that you may have on the unit mm-hmm. that they're willing to share, and you don't push them to go and talk to them, but say that would be a way of getting a bit more of a feeling of what you're going to face. And you leave it and say, in a week from now, I will ask you again. Mm-hmm. You may be in awful hurry to get started, but a week is more of a blessing if a patient is then with it rather than not. And a week later, you again present it to them, and they're still leery and they're still ambivalent, and you still feel that kind of a resistance. And then you go through it a second time in all the details, the cost, the side effects, everything. And I always tell them, I will ask you one more time, but one thing you need to know is if next week when I will ask you for the last time whether you want this kind of treatment, you should choose to say no, thank you. One thing you need to know, that I will always be your doctor. That means I will not reject you if you don't do what would please me the most. Mm-hmm. And that really, really works. And the same thing I do when people ask, should the patient be told? I give people a choice. And if they're not ready, they're not ready and you don't talk about it. Mm-hmm. My best example was a woman who had cancer, and I think she knew internally. And I probably knew, but there was no certainty. And so before the surgery, I said to her, what kind of a woman are you? Are you somebody who just wants to know the truth? You know, blunt out and that's it, and then you cope with it? Or do you want me to go gentle and give you a little bit at a time? And she said, no, why don't we make a deal? If it's malignant, I want you to be in the recovery room. And make sure that I'm awake, so I register that you're there, because that tells me that it was malignant. And then don't talk to me. Go out to the hallway and talk to my husband. When I'm ready, I will call you, and then I'll ask what I'm ready to deal with. And it worked fabulous. I was in the recovery room, and I waited and waited, and she didn't give me a cue, so I waited. After a while, she said, can't you remember our arrangement? Why don't you go talk to my husband? Like, boom. Mm-hmm. But I needed to be sure, so I talked to her husband, who took it very hard, but he dealt with it. And then, I can't remember how many days, like 3-4 days later, she called me mm-hmm. and said, okay, sit down, let's get it out. What are the choices? What are the prognoses? How mm-hmm. much time? And you talk to them. Mm-hmm.
She knew, because of your agreement, that your very presence in the recovery room was the answer to her question.
Yes.
Was it malignant?
But you really, if you are really doing things like this, which all new doctors usually, you know, they don't have years of experience, mm-hmm. and they're a little leery about it. To me, it's much better if you make the arrangement with the patient before you know.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it's a kind of a faking.
Mm-hmm.
And the patient knows, and you know, and mm-hmm. you kind of talk by each other.
Sure.
If you're not 100% sure,
mm-hmm.
and the patient internally knows, but up here doesn't want to know,
mm-hmm.
now that's the best time to make the arrangement.
Mm-hmm. So really asking the patient how they want to be told the information concerning.
And always give people free choice.
Mm-hmm.
To me, the biggest crime that we commit is to deprive people of free choice.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the hardest thing to deal with when you have small children.
Yeah.
Because moms and dads, or whoever is your guardian, has to make a choice for a child.
Mm-hmm.
And they very much underestimate the inner wisdom of little children.
Mm-hmm. How do you recommend that medical students and interns approach a child with news of a life-threatening illness like a cancer or the discovery of leukemia?
I would like courses to be introduced into medical school in a symbolic language.
Can you say a little more about
the language of the intuitive quadrant?
Mm-hmm.
Those children don't know up here that they have a brainstem tumor.
Mm-hmm.
They don't even know intellectually what cancer is or a brainstem. I mean, they have no idea about that. But the inner knowledge, which has, you know, all the wisdom and knowledge in the world, it's just not up here, knows those things. So you teach courses in how does the intuitive quadrant, how does the symbolic language manifest that you can read it, that an outsider can read it. And you show them collages. What does a collage look like that a young kid who is in the process of committing suicide, desperately pleads for help? They can't go to mom and say, I'm going to kill myself.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes they do, you know, in their anger and despair, but they can't really come out point blank.
Mm-hmm.
So they write poetry, the saddest poems in the world.
Mm-hmm.
They make drawings that when you look at it, you get goose pimples. You see that it's an impotent rage and hopelessness and helplessness, but you don't quite know what to do with a picture like this. I have a collage here, maybe we can show it on a videotape of
sure.
a young girl.
Mm-hmm.
So spontaneous drawings, spontaneous poems that people don't think what rhymes, but it just comes out.
Mm-hmm.
Or a spontaneous picture is a language of the spiritual intuitive quadrant. If we would teach courses for teachers, especially for teachers, they would look at the first grade class and look at their spontaneous drawing. They could already elicit that 25% of the children who have been traumatized before they enter first grade. Mm. 25% of our workshop participants grew up with incest and physical abuse.
Mm-hmm.
You'll never see it outside. But boy, when you look at their picture, you see how they're traumatized.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you can help a child like this in first grade and help them deal with it and help the family who is involved, you could do so much preventive medicine, preventive psychiatry, but we don't pick it up until they're 40 and 50. They beat their kids, they misuse their kids, and it says, father's sins will be passed on to the children, and children's children
mm-hmm.
will pass on all our unfinished business.
Mm-hmm.
And all these things should be dealt with before we're grown up. If you have medical students who go into medicine because of a lot of unfinished business, and they overcompensate their own inner anguish and impotence and rage and whatnot, they'll be marvelous, loving physicians, but they overcompensate until one point it just breaks, and then they either have a psychotic episode or they commit suicide.
Mm-hmm.
That's why psychiatrists have the highest rates of suicide. They are caregivers,
mm-hmm.
but they do not have a safe place in a medical school system, for example, to go and get it all out and mm-hmm. be accepted.
Mm-hmm.
Because a doctor is supposed to help others and not bring their own stuff.
Yeah.
We do need in a medical curriculum, what I'm saying about medical curriculum is equally true of chaplains and nurses and
sure.
all healthcare professionals. We need a safe place where people can look in the mirror and say, I'm overreacting to these kind of children, for example, or to children who have amputations. Or when I see a little child, it's just my heart goes out to them and I get paralyzed.
Mm-hmm.
You have to help them to find out where that hurt and pain comes from,
mm-hmm.
or that rage or that need to run away or to overcompensate. And if you can find that out and deal with that, you can help 17 hours a day, 7 days a week. You can be with dying children,
mm-hmm.
and children with cancers, and you just love them, and it does not drain you.
Mm-hmm.
You need to help them to find out where their own unfinished business is, in order not to drain them to a point. You have that fabulous name, burnout syndrome.
Yeah.
You know, if you could help nurses, mm-hmm. and doctors and hospital chaplains not to get, quote, into the burnout syndrome. Mm-hmm. Burnout syndrome means nothing else but somebody else pushes my button of unfinished business. I cannot admit it. I don't have a safe place to let it all out.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm going to keep the lid on. And that drains your energy enormously.
I want to come back to that in a few moments when we're talking about coping with health on the part of health professionals. But let's pick up on the patient, kind of going back a bit to the patient who has just discovered that here in the midst of life, really whatever age, because I think most of us tend to look ahead at life as an open-ended agenda. Here in the midst of life, there has been a diagnosis of a fatal or at least a life-threatening illness. And all of a sudden, there's a radical turnaround in terms of that person's ability to cope with the everyday problems of that situation. What do you find is helpful? What do people draw on that helps them cope with the imminence of death, with that, I guess we could call it the final trajectory of life?
Can I object the word you use over and over again, that's coping?
Yeah.
It's a bad word, okay, in my dictionary. Coping means grasping for straws, mm. to me, like just barely hanging in there.
Mm-hmm.
If you have to cope, there's something wrong.
So it's kind of a minimalistic term,
yeah,
as you think of it.
I think every human being has their own way of dealing with something that comes to you unexpectedly. And the variable whether people deal with something with stoic acceptance, with tears and marinating in their own self-pity,
mm-hmm.
To anger and rage and impotence. I mean, there's a whole scale of mechanisms. Depends totally, almost exclusively, how they were able to deal with traumas when they were very, very young.
Mm-hmm.
Like if you have a mom who is very concerned with other people, think of you and how the family looks and has to present nice, and you're 5 years old and you want to take your security blanket on a walk, and mom says that looks filthy and you're a big boy now, not a little baby, and tosses it in a fireplace, and you see your absolute beloved security blanket go up in the fire. He will have such a total anguish and cannot conceive that somebody can be so cruel and sadistic. Any time later on he has a loss of anything, whether that's your vision or a leg or you have cancer or grandma dies or a pet gets killed on the highway, the memory of that trauma,
mm-hmm.
and the closing off because he can't scratch mom's eyes out or whatever he wants to do, will repeat itself over and over and over again. So it's terribly important to raise future moms and dads to begin to see what they raise in their children, the way they cope with what for you may be a little thing, a security blanket,
mm-hmm.
but for a child it's the whole life. If they have a grandma, the child comes home from school and there's a torn dress or a hole in the pants or whatever, mother already stands there and says, just wait until dad comes home, he's gonna give it to you, and you know you have to wait 4 hours until father comes home from the business, by then you can't even remember why you get the spanking. Then he humiliates you and you have to go the, whatever, the belt. Mm-hmm. And you have to pull your pants down and stand there and get the punishment for something that's for you already in the past. There is no way that you can deal with all this unfairness and anger. All you need is a grandma who stands under the door and gives you a loving look and knows on some level what you go through, the humiliation, mm-hmm. the anger, the inability to just scream and say, that's not fair. Can we talk about it? You don't know how I got that torn dress or those torn pants. Nobody talks to you and you just get bashed, and maybe afterwards they talk about it. You will respond to all the future dramas like this. If you have a grandma who just gives you a loving look, and then when you're sent to your room after you get your spanking, pull your pants up, she steps out and hugs you silently. And what she conveys to you is, I love you no matter what you do. Mm-hmm. That was not a nice thing to do, but I will always love you. That kind of experience of unconditional love will sustain you. And they talk later on, they even talk on their deathbed about that one person who sustained them and made them survive all sorts of painful traumas. If people would know a bit how important grandmas are, and it's usually you have to skip a generation.
The immediate generation may be too involved, too much of themselves involved.
Yeah, also
involved.
Feels very irresponsible, mm-hmm. how they look to the outside world, mm-hmm. and they have to keep a certain image, and all those funny values, mm-hmm. you know, which we have been raised with. A grandma is really not responsible. And she's all the time in the world to just love you. It's much easier for a grandma to love a grandchild than for a mom or a dad. Mm-hmm. So you have to accept that reality, too.
So you seem to be saying that that kind of acceptance, a really kind of unconditional love that a grandmother, grandfather can give, helps prepare a person in dealing with the losses and traumas that will come in the future.
If a child was raised with unconditional love, and firm, consistent discipline, which is equally important to love, mm-hmm. by the way. They are totally prepared for life. I mean, totally. Mm-hmm. They can die at age 20, mm-hmm. and maybe have 2 weeks of an acute leukemia and die, and they will have no anxiety about living nor dying. But most of us have been raised what we call normal, but not natural. Mm-hmm. We've never been allowed to express anger. We've never been really allowed to cry, admit, to feel it's okay to cry. The moment we cry, somebody comes and puts a hand on you and says, implicitly or explicitly, don't cry, it's all right. Mm-hmm. But it's not all right to just mm-hmm. be told that you have 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. If we would, people who have just been informed of a potentially terminal illness, and you don't know yet if they have a good chance or a bad chance, but they've just been hit with that, you go through a shock for a while and numbness. But sooner or later, it's going to defrost and it's going to come out. Mm-hmm. If people would not immediately come with antidepressants or Valium, tranquilizers, but let them have a good cry, mm-hmm. and just get it out and use whatever language comes, it's okay. I'd be angry too. And if you're afraid to be angry at God, you tell him God can take it, he's bigger than us. And you give them an explicit okay. That whatever comes up, get it out, and then you can use the energy that you use to keep the lid on and keep that nice smiling mm-hmm. face. And
when you're really angry.
Yeah, and all that energy is then free to fight your illness or mm-hmm. whatever you need to do, to have the stamina to go through the chemotherapy. But see, if doctors, to use just one health professional, always have to keep that nice front. They're not supposed to cry. They're not supposed to curse. They're not supposed to get angry. They're always supposed to be nice, neatly dressed, make their rounds, and give good advice. And it's not natural. Mm-hmm. It's not real. Mm-hmm. If patients would see that the doctor can cry sometimes or can be just so frustrated they need to take half a day off. Mm-hmm. Or one day I made a house call. And I really love that woman, but there are days when you just don't want to be nice. You don't want to be good. You just want to go home cook dinner for your kids and stretch your feet out and do nothing. And that's how I absolutely felt. I mean, as much as I loved that patient that day, I didn't want to go to her. Well, I'm raised like most doctors. You make a commitment, you have an appointment, you keep it. Responsibility. So my car went to her house. I sat in it, but I wasn't with it. I walked into the door, and she always left her door open this much because she was alone during the day and very, very sick, full of cancer. And I opened the door, and I, as smiling as I could put up a smile, I said, hi. And she took one look at me and said, you don't want to be here today. And I almost said, hey, you know how much I love to come and see you. It would have been a lie. And I just looked at her, and finally I said, no, there are days I just want to be home with my kids. And she said, do me a favor, don't even come here. Turn around, go home, because that would give me permission on certain days I really don't feel like having a visitor. I just had an enema or something. And I don't have the nerve to tell you turn around because you come half a way out of your way to visit me. But if you go home now and you feel really okay about it, next time I feel that way, I can tell you, and I just make, and you take off, and it's okay.
Yeah.
I turned around so fast, like you wouldn't believe it. And about 2 weeks later, I came in, and she made the signal. I said goodbye. That's the honesty.
It's equality, also.
Yeah, it's a form of honesty that we have to learn again. Because you're human, too. You have days when you just feel icky. And from then on, we had just a marvelous relationship. That's something is also not taught in medical school.
The relational aspect?
Yeah, and also to be human and to acknowledge your weaknesses. And days when you feel icky and you just don't feel like being nice.
Well, that really does move us directly into the next area I wanted to consider, because many nurses and doctors, when they let their hair down and are honest, will say, boy, sometimes I really just don't want to go to work. Or the stresses of being with my patients is too overwhelming for me. And I think you and I have talked before about having screening rooms or places where people can let their feelings out and ventilate their feelings. But I'd like to go a step further and see what kind of suggestions you have for nurses and doctors who feel themselves to be often in that kind of pressured situation. What can help them to gain that inner peace?
One thing they cannot do is to just stay home. That has to be clear. There has to be a certain discipline that you can't just call in sick when you're not really sick. People who are depleted, and just it gets too draining, or certain patients make them just too tired, really need to look at their own life, what these patients remind them of. Is it old people who are sick and can't live and can't die? Is it the memory of a grandma who existed this way, and then they withdrew, and then 2 years later they got the phone call, grandma died, and the guilt of having deserted that lovely grandma that may have taught you to dance when you were 7 and 10 years old and was always here for you, and you left her and really have never dealt with your guilt and your grief and your inability to say goodbye and thank you to her. Finish your unfinished business. You'll have to do it sooner or later, because otherwise every old person who looks or smells the same way will remind you, and you put the lid on and you get drained. So you really need to evaluate what kind of people, what kind of situations you react to, and then find a safe place and somebody who knows how to do that, to deal with it. If you have no unfinished business, you cannot get trained.
Well, nurses in particular have shared with me the feeling that they've cared for a patient, let's say, a patient with leukemia, and they've been with that patient over a period of a couple of years through relapses and remissions, and the patient dies, and they have their own grief and mourning as though they've lost a member of their own family. And then they've related to me how difficult it is to go back and pick up a new patient and begin to form those same attachments. And
then they have some unfinished business of grief work. Mm-hmm. Not grief, but grief work. Because if you are with a patient 2-3 years and you really go with them through relapses and remission, if you have no problems with grief, you would go through the preparatory grief before mm-hmm. the patient dies. Mm-hmm. And by the time the patient dies, if there is that much time, mm-hmm. you would have accepted the reality of that person's death. Mm-hmm. You would have grief, you would be missing them, you would think of them many times, many kind of special days or special pictures or special kind of food that you used to smuggle in would remind you of that patient, but not in a draining way, mm-hmm. in a more happy, sad way, but not draining of energy. If you have grief work to do, then you've not dealt with some old unfinished business. If you have really gotten involved with a young person, usually, where there is a pretty good chance that they will respond to the treatment, and all your hope is up that, God, we're going to make it, and you put out all your energy for that person to make it, and then you come on the next shift and you're told that this child died. That is much more difficult to deal with, because then you have not given yourself permission to deal with the probability or possibility of losing that patient. And you have put like all your eggs in one basket, mm-hmm. and then it hits you like an avalanche. Mm-hmm. That is much more difficult to cope with. Uh-huh. But if you have gone with a patient 2-3 years and you still have trouble switching gears, then you have unfinished business.
I see. So you're really making a distinction between the natural grief that any of us might experience,
yes.
over the loss of a life or a relationship.
It's a big difference.
And grief work, yeah. Which is sort of that old unfinished business. From
grief work always includes some fear, guilt, or shame, usually.
Mm-hmm.
Or regrets, if I had done only this or that.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to deal with it, because if you don't, you push it down, and then you come up with the next patient or next year.
And so a big part of what you're speaking about is not learning about patients, but about learning about ourselves as well.
It's
learning about that inner self.
Everything about you.
Medical education, as you've described it, should really be an opportunity to learn a lot more about ourselves, our history, our unfinished agenda.
If I would be a professor in a medical school now,
mm-hmm.
and I would have a ward with 50 patients, and you are my interns or residents or young doctors, I would have you signed up to certain patients, and I would not want to know the size of the liver. I wouldn't want to know how many white blood cells you have. That another professor can deal with that.
Uh-huh.
All I would want you to get involved with the patient and find out, what buttons does he push on you?
Mm-hmm.
Good ones and bad ones. And then deal with what kind of things and people and moments and communications do you react to more than 15 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
Boy, would you learn something about yourself. That would be wonderful.
Then the learning would begin.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's painful, but it's so eye-opening and so freeing and liberating, mm-hmm. when you don't react to the same things over and over again.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Maybe we should invent that.
That'd be all right.
Yeah.
A new strategy for education. I think it's important. Let me address a particular problem that occurs here in a center like Seattle, where we have a bone marrow transplant procedure that's probably been done more frequently here than any place in the country. It does offer hope for life-sustaining treatment, as you know, but often the percentages, here we get into the statistical
mm-hmm.
percentages may be low, and they may require the family to move across the country, to be here for a number of months, for the patient to be in a laminar airflow room, isolated from the family for weeks. And of course, what we've been talking about is a kind of connection with the person who is undergoing treatment and who may be in the terminal phase of life. Here's maybe a last resort of technological intervention, and yet it kind of denies the patient so much of the human aspect of care at the end of life. Do you see this as an ethical dilemma to offer such a treatment to a patient, or should we just offer that as a choice and respect the wishes of the patients?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. You should offer it to them as a possibility, mm-hmm. as an alternative. You need to be more honest with the patients and the family about the real chances. Mm-hmm. The day before I came here, I got the phone call from the East Coast from a mother who is a single mother of 5 children. And she has a 9-year-old child who is now offered this possibility. She has no help. She cannot really give informed consent. It's mm-hmm. beyond her to cope with all these children, and then here you make the decision. But implicitly, if you don't say yes, you know, you'll be responsible. And so after really talking about it, what are the possibilities? What is it like for the patient, for a little child to be in that bubble and isolated, and all the aspects of it? She finally had the courage to ask the doctor, what are his chances? Mm-hmm. And she got the very brusque 10%. Mm. And she said, well, that means, you know, 9 out of 10 chances that he's not going to make it, yes. And then he walks away. Mm. And 10% for her was very little, considering what was involved. And then we asked what kind of a thing he had, and the end result was that she asked for 2 consultations by other not personally involved physicians, and they told her that she had a 0.5% chance with the kind of illness her child had. And she said, with 0.5% of a chance, I cannot afford to leave my other children and to go through this emotional and financial and total nightmare for my child. Mm-hmm. And I think it is very important. That's another part of honesty.
Yeah.
Don't embellish it. Mm-hmm. Don't make it sound that it's so great when it's really mm-hmm. a very, very difficult decision to make. And if you can include the children, mm-hmm. and if you can, if you have somebody who knows the symbolic language, you can give them options of a drawing meet about all the possibilities of treatment, like we did last time on the mm-hmm. tape, and find out if this child has a chance at all.
Yes.
And you have a possibility of knowing ahead of time whether it even has a chance. Mm-hmm. If it has no chance, don't offer it. Mm-hmm. Because it breaks the heart of parents to have to say no thank you, and then a child dies. Mm-hmm. And then they think forever, God, if we had said yes, you think he would still be alive. So you have to be very honest, mm-hmm. give them time, give them 2-3 consultations if necessary, and then make the decision.
I think that's sometimes where nurses feel in a bind if the physician is more optimistic and embellishes it a bit, and they feel that realistically the chances are much lower.
I always say get the outside consultation,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and then they can have a much more informed consent.
Mm-hmm.
They know that we need to embellish it a little bit,
mm-hmm.
so they can take off a few percentage on their own.
Uh-huh.
I mean, they know that mm-hmm. you know, we are human too.
Yeah.
But if you use the symbolic language, if you use consultations, and if you really sit and not in a hurry and not look at the watch, for some people, this is a possibility. Small percentage of people.
Mm-hmm. You've given us a lot of insight about the nature that medical education needs to take in the future to, of course, learn the objective facts we need to know about healthcare delivery, but most especially to learn about ourselves, to learn about our own unfinished agenda, and to be attentive to our own inner feelings and our own past, in order that we can truly be present to the patients whom we serve.
And also to always ask yourself, whose needs do I gratify?
Whose needs?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Is it mine if I'm honest, mm-hmm. or do I really take care of the needs of the patient? Mm-hmm. If it becomes a give and take, medicine is the most beautiful profession.
Mm-hmm.
If you learn that balance.
Mm-hmm. How do you keep that balance for yourself, Elisabeth?
I do what feels right and what feels good and what I love to do.
Mm-hmm.
And if I'm pushed into too many things that really not my cup of tea, I have to learn to say no, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And keep your honesty and
Yeah. Keep
your freedom.
And if I don't, my patients will remind me and give me a little,
a little kick.
And I say, I'm getting it. I'm beginning to slip.
Yeah.
And then you get back on the track. You also know when you feel good, physically good, you have energy and you feel good, you know you're on the right track.
Mm-hmm.
If you get trained and feel like an old, worn-out record, then you know you have to reevaluate why you continue to do what you're doing.
Oh, good point.
You really need to review from time to time.
Mm-hmm.
Did you just get into an old track? Like a bobsled, you know, who just has no choice but get stuck now?
Mm-hmm.
Or can you do your own path? Maybe it's time to change. You need to do that too from time to time.
To listen to those inner signals and mm-hmm. the symbolic language of our own intuitive quadrant. Elisabeth, I always feel energized and renewed by talking with you, and
you.
I appreciate your willingness to share your insights and your experience so that we can in turn share this with young health professionals as they prepare for service to patients.
I'm very happy for your help and grateful that you allow us to record all this here.
Thank you.
Thank you.